Hello, everyone. This open source project started over 2 years ago, and I'm super happy with all the support it's received, and I'm so excited that it's evolved into a super capable little development board. And with this new revision, even more so. The first version of the board was super limited, and you had to resort to low-level assembly programming to get almost anything at all running. And I'm super happy to announce that hasn't changed at all. But it did get some major upgrades that makes it a more powerful platform and easier to use. It is still, without a doubt, the easiest way to get 6502 instructions running on real silicon from the 1970s and 80s with no modern parts doing the heavy lifting and nothing that couldn't have been done in the 70s with a real 6502. And speaking of the 6502, it's hard to believe it's been so long, but 2025 marks the 50th anniversary of the 6502 introduction, one of the most influential microprocessors in computing history. After half a century, it's still one of the most amazing pieces of tech the world has ever seen. Not because it's particularly powerful, especially by 2025 standards, it wasn't even close to being the most powerful CPU of 1975. Not because it had a long list of integrated features with only 56 instructions, not because it was particularly future-proof with only a 16-bit address space, not because it was designed to be a game designer's dream CPU. According to Chuck Peddle, who designed the architecture, it was actually more intended to be the CPU of a cash register than a general-purpose computer. The 6502, in my opinion, was an amazing piece of tech because it enabled people to abstract away a lot of confusion and complications and focus on making the most amazing computers and software with a set of limitations that made it easy to understand what you really needed to know. Limitations force you to work with what you have. Limitations force you to learn the basics. The limitations of the 6502 force you to walk before you can teleport. If you look at the spec sheet of a modern embedded system development board without a pretty deep understanding of what half the features are, you're bound to get confused, you'll end up feeling overwhelmed, and you might give up before you've even started. And even though you might be able to hack together some pretty cool things that does stuff the 6502 couldn't even dream of, without the basics and without a strong foundation, it's a lot harder to make good solutions. And it's a lot harder to work with the limitations instead of running into them like a brick wall. I'm not saying you should stay with the tech of the 1970s forever, but what I am saying is that knowing how a computer worked in the 70s will make it a lot easier to work with computer architecture and embedded systems in 2025. By knowing what a register is, by working with a limited amount of RAM, by setting up a timer, and by getting a feel for how many CPU cycles get eaten up by an action you want to do in the real world, you'll earn some real skills that'll be useful for the next 50 years. So if you're new to the 6502, that's the point. Not just that it's fun to play with super retro integrated circuits, but also that it'll dress you up with a set of useful skills you won't regret having later. The first revision of the 6502 was a big success. It was just a smaller 6502, the 6507, a ROM, and a 6532 RAM, I/O, and timer chip, along with a pair of voltage regulators, a 1 MHz oscillator, and a single gate for address decoding. If the goal in itself was limitations, that certainly achieved it. With a 50-year-old CPU running at 1 MHz, 4 KB ROM space, 2 I/O ports, a timer, and only 128 bytes of RAM, that's about as limited as you can make a system and still call it a computer. And over the last 2 years, I've spent a good deal of my free time showing how you can take a super limited single board computer like this and do a ton of the same things you'd use a modern microcontroller to do. I've used it to twiddle pins, I've implemented I2C in 6502 assembly, I've written a library to control SSD 1306 OLED displays, I've used it as a serial Linux terminal, I've written games to play on it, and as you might have heard, I've used it to develop a relatively universal ROM programmer that works on other UNO-style dev boards, of course. But today, I'd like to present the 65 Arduino Revision 1, along with some cool software upgrades. First of all, the board now comes with USB-C instead of micro USB. When the first version came out, micro USB was still cheaper, and I liked the idea of giving home builders the option to use leftover stock of micro USB besides it being easier to solder. The new footprint is still super cheap. It's the kind that's at least still possible to hand solder, and 2025 should be the year we can finally be sure any new device comes with USB-C. Even Apple is on board with that. And speaking of USB-C, one of the biggest upgrades to the board is that the USB connector doesn't just power the board. It's also the 65 Arduino's USB to serial port, as the board now includes a CH340G USB to serial chip. So you no longer need a separate UART dongle to program via serial. And if you pull the 6532 Riot chip, you can use the board as a serial adapter by itself. By default, the 65 Arduino is now configured to reset using the DTR line, so you can upload a new program without touching the board, even if it's stuck in a loop. Another thing I decided to include is onboard overclocking, or underclocking for that matter. The oscillator on the board has changed from a 1 MHz CAN oscillator to an 8 MHz one. That doesn't mean the CPU will run at that speed, but since an 8 MHz CAN oscillator is cheaper and less rare than a 1 MHz CAN, we can divide down the 8 MHz clock and get the other clock options for free. The NMOS 6502 CPU die won't run at 8 MHz, but my experience tells me it'll run at 2 MHz no problem. However, I have a feeling the 6532 Riot chip won't be happy running that fast though. So if you do run the 6507 at 2 MHz, you'll have to use an external IC for some of the tasks. And speaking of external ICs, with Revision 1, the options for hooking up external ICs like registers, a second 6532 for testing, a 6522, or whatever you want really, is completely opened up. Since not only does it have the 8-bit data bus and 11 address bits broken out onto headers, it also has the control signals broken out and a 74HC138 decoding 3 unused 1K address segments. This means hooking up more ROM, RAM, or whatever memory map chip you want is a complete breeze, with the limitation of staying within the available address space, of course. A big shout out to JLC PCB for sponsoring this project and making these iterations possible. If you're not familiar with them, JLC PCB offers affordable, reliable, and hassle-free PCB manufacturing and assembly services. Getting your PCBs fully assembled is incredibly straightforward, and with their $30 coupon, you can snag high-quality 6-layer boards for just $5. This even includes premium features like gold finish and via in-pad technology. No extra engineering costs required. Once again, I am super happy with the quality and speed of their assembly services and shipping. I would not be able to do these projects if it wasn't for their support and super convenient services. For those of you that haven't tried building a 6502 computer on a breadboard or have been buried deep in a Commodore 64, this might all seem a bit complicated. So let me take a step back before we move on to the new software features. What the 65 Arduino tries to do is to be an accessible tool for learning and prototyping. If you want to learn 6502 assembly code or want to learn how a computer was built in the 70s, the idea is you can simply plug it into your modern computer and send it a little bit of code via USB and see what it does. If you want to see how easy it is to blink an LED using a real 6502, then the 65 Arduino is for you. If you're already deep into retro computing and making an add-on for an old 6502 computer and you want to test it with a real 6502 bus without risking your Apple II, this 65 Arduino makes it super easy to hook something up. If you've been thinking of building a 6502 computer on a breadboard but don't really have the time, then the 65 Arduino is for you. Although I might have moved things around a bit and put them on a PCB and added an integrated USB connection, the heart of the 65 Arduino Revision 1 is still the simple combination of less than a handful of chips I got to fit on a breadboard 2 years ago, making it the easiest way to run 6502 code on real DIP chips in 2025. Now, onto the software. The idea has always been that you can take advantage of the built-in routines in ROM and upload your code via serial to RAM. And if you need more space, you would add your own routines to ROM. That works great if you're sitting comfortably at your workbench with a full-size keyboard and everything you need to send code via serial. However, it's always felt like something's missing. A few weeks ago, I was sitting on a plane with a 65 Arduino in my hand and a USB plug right there. When you have a little gadget with a screen and a button that's just begging to be played with, it's super frustrating you need to hook it up to a laptop to get anything running. So I fixed that. First of all, the 65 Arduino used to boot into a little welcome screen and just sit there blinking its LED, either waiting for serial data to display on the screen, ready to act like a little 128 character old school terminal, or expecting a program via serial. Instead of the welcome message, it now boots into a main menu system, letting you choose between the features assembled into ROM, so you at least have Flappy Laris to play if you're stuck on a plane with nothing but a 65 Arduino and a USB cable. You simply click the user button to switch between items and long press to select. And of course, it's still ready to receive text or code via serial. But that's not it though. Of course, learning 6502 assembly mnemonics and putting them through an assembler on a modern computer is fun and gives you an idea what the output of a compiler boils down to. But there's also a certain allure to actually memorizing the 6502 opcodes, knowing them by heart, and whispering to the 6502 in its native 8-bit language, where each of them has a specific function. The goal was pretty simple. I wanted to be able to run custom 6502 instructions without using another computer to assemble the code, even if it turned out to be a pretty cumbersome way to write code. So, did I write an assembler for the 65 Arduino? Not quite, yet anyway, but now you get to be the assembler. I wrote a monitor program that lets you read any part of the memory map and modify it. The way it works right now is you can select one byte at a time and increment it. The value isn't saved until you long press to return, so you can use it to set I/O directions and ports without affecting other pins. At the moment, it's quite a few presses to set a specific value, so I think I'll update the code to edit one nibble at a time so you don't have to press the button a worst case of 255 times to change a 1 to a 0. If you want to help out making things better, I'd love it if you submit a pull request on GitHub or just come say hi in the Hackerspace Clubhouse on Discord. If you do a normal reset of the 65 Arduino, it clears all RAM to initialize it to a known state, but if you've just spent half an hour writing a program pressing a button thousands of times, you probably don't want that. So what you do is hold down the user button while pressing reset. You might have noticed there's also a menu entry for an I2C scanner, but I haven't actually written that code yet. But considering the I2C code is already there and a lot of the code monitor code can be reused, expect to see that feature working soon. You might also notice there's no mention of the programmer in the menu. And that's because the 4K ROM address space is starting to fill up. So, by default, it's not assembled in ROM. I probably should have thought about this before, but it might have been a good idea to add a jumper or two to allow banking the ROM address lines, since most ROMs these days are a bit bigger than 4K anyway. That way, you could put some features in one part of ROM and a different set in another. But that's an idea for the future. I also added a silly airplane mode entry to the menu, which will actually put the 65 Arduino into the least active state possible by executing one of the jam instructions, which will lock up the CPU and require a reset to continue. I don't know how long before revision 1.1 comes out, but there are a few tiny things I'd like to change. If you order a revision 1 from my store before they sell out, you might get one with a solder blob on the clock divider IC U2. That's completely intentional since I forgot to connect pin 10 high, because the previous design I copied it from used an LS version, which doesn't strictly require that pin to be externally pulled high. A good reminder to double check things when moving to a different IC version. If you use the Gerber files on GitHub, that's already been fixed. I hope you appreciate what I've done with the board and like the progress so far. Either way, thanks for watching.